Happy Easter Sunday, everyone, and welcome to the Costa del Jaywick. It's that time of the night where we know we're staying home. We're on lockdown. We're saving lives by being locked down. And well done to everyone. I've done my exercise earlier in Jaywick. No, I didn't see hardly anyone on my walks. So everyone's taking their exercise at different times and everyone's abiding by the rules. We are staying home, we are saving lives. And we are, should be all so proud of each other. So shine on, we'll do this as long as it takes because we are staying home to save lives. Please watch the fish with me for half an hour. And you can see that while watching the fish, we're not doing other things. We're staying home to watch the fish. And by staying home, we're saving lives. So happy Easter Sunday, everyone. You are in my thoughts and I love you all. And you can all just love the fish because they are my wish. They're not on the dish. I love my fish. They are my bliss. I love my fish and I hope you all do too. Welcome to watching them with me. And happy Easter Sunday, everybody. Shine on.
Bring British intelligence out of the dark ages.
resident MI6 has been talking about it.
Talking about what, exactly?
That what you did in Mexico was one step too far. That you're finished.
Oh, yes.
I think you're just getting started.
I don't know what you mean.
All right. I think you've got a secret.
ITV2, Family Movie Magic, in association with Warner Brothers Studio Tour London, the making of Harry Potter.
I should be sitting at a desk.
I'm by any one thing, but this might just be the exception. Tresemme Carrot.
done about four or five little pisses. That's four or five less he does inside. He always does his little pisses, leaving his mark, you know? That's what I love about him. It's amazing. It's amazing. Yes, he is. We love that. I'm going to do it to him a little bit, rub them, put the medium on. And then, is that good? Pretty used to it, aren't you? You idiot, you should look where you're poking your nose.
Change, you know? A couple of things to get through. You killed him.
He was innocent. Trust me, you're not a good person.
I was respected.
Loyal to a man you hated.
You trusted my father. You've been gone and rejected him. I can trust nobody.
You never feel what?
Well, I can tell you that I don't trust you.
And then you have an accident.
You don't leave now. We're back together.
I think it was worse ways to go.
For that one, Spectre, I watched that one in the cinema when we did Step Out, remember? This is the film. So it's good memories, you know?
Hello,
it's all right beside you, doesn't he? And then he farts. Oh. Yeah.
After the success of our attack in Hamburg and Tunisia, we reported attacking Mexico City and the death of our valued colleague, Marco Serra. Lead one of the duties, our friend. The campaign must be terminated. Will you make the journey to Alcatraz?
Por supuesto. Levantar esta organización es absoluta. La protección es también bolivia. Una mano aficionada. No debemos más muestras de vida. Welcome, James. It's been a long time. Finally, here we are. What took you so long?
Joining American Honey on the French Riviera was Canadian TV actress Suzanne Lloyd. A guest star on British television and fresh from appearances in series like The Avengers and The Saint, That Riviera Touch would be 32-year-old Suzanne's first feature film.
What I found myself doing was watching Eric like I'm watching a movie. And I thought, oh my God, I'm totally caught up in his funny.
On set, both Eric and Ernie took their comedy very seriously.
I heard that Eric was always cracking jokes. That wasn't my experience. I saw a very serious, caring side to Eric that I found extremely appealing as a human being. And of course, Ernie was like bubbles and champagne. He was just, you know, like giggling and laughing all the time. I just watched the movie again. And I saw her kind of looking at it, and I smiled at him. That was
Claudette.
That was Suzanne. I just
looked
at the fans. I just loved him. Sorry.
Throughout their golden era, Rank Film Studios sent photographers to capture life on set. Their publicity photos, captured in these blue books, have lain in vaults unseen for decades. 50 years after filming on the French Riviera, and now living in L.A., Suzanne Lloyd is laying eyes on these remarkable pictures for the very first time.
Oh my. I was so thin. I know I was thinking very much about my thigh at that point, because my thigh was going to be huge for the camera. This is Ernie and I. He was very easy to work with. And I've got my legs all wrapped around him, and we both look very happy. Eric and Ernie were alive, I would be fine. This is really hard because they're not. How wonderful to go back 50 years to a time when I was so happy. I'm happy now, but I was really happy then, working with the boys.
On the other side of the Atlantic, Eric's wife Joan can now relive her happy memories of that Riviera touch and share photographs she's never seen before with daughter Gail.
They're both killing themselves in love.
Oh, fantastic.
It's a wonderful place to be. Well, that's
yeah, he'd enjoy that moment. And I hope you're sitting somewhere surrounded by very nice looking men. I think that would have been nice. I'm a hero. Yeah, you're a hero, Mum, and I bet you kept your socks on for that. This is a man that I never saw in water with no socks on her.
And everyone else is sort of probably looking over there because they're laughing.
Yeah.
Fantastic.
Yeah, thank you. Never knew.
After a third and final film, by 1967, Morgan and Wise had made their sixth series of two of a kind for Old Grade and ITV. But as ever, they had an eye on the future. The BBC had begun broadcasting in colour, and colour TV sets could now be bought on a high street or rented for £8 a month.
I think they felt they were outgrowing probably the money, but also the half-hour black and white format.
25-year-old TV agent Michael Gray began negotiations for their new contract with his uncle, Lew Gray, of ITV. Morecambe and Wise wanted more money, a longer running time, and crucially, to be seen in colour.
Lou was an old agent, and you know, he liked to negotiate. And Eric and Ernie liked to negotiate. They were never greedy, they wanted to get what they thought they were worth. And believe me, they were worth every penny, whatever they got, ever.
Lou Gray dug his heels in, and Michael Gray, despite his family connections, went to Bill Cotton, the head of live entertainment at the BBC.
opportunity. I said to Bill, these are the terms, and if you agree, they will sign with the BBC. He could hardly believe his luck, really. And then I had to ring Uncle Lou and tell him that Eric and Ernie were signing with the BBC. He took it very well. He knew that he'd lost the game. And that took them to a whole new level.
Walker and Wise debuted their first series in colour on the BBC on the 2nd of September 1968. But an unexpected setback would call a halt to their success. Alongside their TV series, Eric and Ernie had continued to tour, but the workload was starting to take its toll on Eric's health. In a diary entry, while appearing in summer season at Great Yarmouth, he noted, I have a slight pain on the left side around my heart. It's most likely wind, but I've had it for about 4 days. That's a hell of a time to have wind. On the 8th of November 1968, driving home from a gig at the Battle Variety Club near Leeds, Eric Morecambe suffered a massive heart attack at the age of 42.
It was far more severe than we ever let on really to the public. One didn't think that he would ever work again.
4 years later, Eric Morecambe would recount the events of that night on the Parkinson Show.
At the time of the car, it was getting worse. I was shot with her in Leeds. I said, you know, I don't feel very well. Do you think you could hold against me, though, okay? And I said, do you feel? You could take me to a hospital, I don't feel very well. I thought they'd walk the body with, I'll never forget it. So he said, oh, well, I never did want to leave. I'm carrying the territorials, I wanted to do this, Dan.
24-year-old Walter Butterworth, a cadet from the Territorial Army, was on his way home from a night out when he had an encounter which has stayed with him for nearly 50 years.
I've just accelerated. Pop it once.
So I get in there, with 70,000 quick ones, and
it was, it's very fast. Nice motor.
Well, I got them to say, well, I thought you were scared, you know.
It's one of the biggest moments of my life. I've never saved anybody's life before, so I'm just proud over here.
Today, Walter is meeting Gary Morecambe for the first time since he helped save his father's life. But there's another surprise in store for Walter here at Silverstone. A chance to get behind the wheel of the very same car in which he drove Eric to hospital.
Okay, we get a chance as well. Everything immaculate in this one. Certainly is. First to work up, can you come over to the nearest hospital? Nobody's checking on something over a bit. Just accelerate anymore.
You must have enjoyed that, Riff.
You often mentioned your name
in our afternoon, so you're a big part of the story.
I'm just proud
over
here.
I think
that
you should have
seen this in
the car,
you
haven't done that for 50 years, have you?
True.
Go on.
It's still
as well as I'm. I won't say you were a lot younger then, but you were a lot younger. What is this? Oh, it's broken. Alright, here we go for the first thing. Any questions, by the way?
He's not going to sell much ice cream, not at that speed, is he?
It's all on to be cracking. I'm at the age of 12. And here I am all these decades later in my 60s. Sitting in it, the car's in a lot better condition than I am.
Abbott would have been proud of us.
I want a bit hotter than this though, no doors were open.
Oh, I can't imagine.
Keep going, you fool.
Thanks for saving my father's life.
Thanks very much.
Were it not for Walter putting his foot down 50 years ago, we might have missed out on some of the most popular moments in TV history.
What do you think of so far?
Work ahead of them.
I admired them like mad because they were so brilliant.
Walkman and Rice forever. His own show on Christmas Day. There's rare footage of the boys at work with one of their favourite guest stars.
Oh, it's lovely to have all these memories again.
And Eric's son Gary remembers family holidays where some magical television moments were created.
He got inspired, you know, a couple of great Walker Wise moments have come from being here. Kids, we just thought, wow, you know, not one of those ideas. It might happen, it might not.
What's your name?
Call up James.
It's half inch. Let me leave a few in the fridge for me. Beautiful, that is orange chocolate. That is so sexy. So are you.
So are you, baby.
Sexy. You need that wide open, that door. Leaving the you watch fish, stay home and save life.
It's a place of possibilities where fortunes can be made, but where dreams can be crushed by two simple words. I'm out. First to face the dragons are Razan Alsus and Ragged Sandeep, two entrepreneurs who've made it to the den from the
When we decided to leave Syria, it was really, really very bad. There was a massive bombing next to my office. We took our lives, our kids, and that's it.
Forced to flee Syria, the family found a new home 3,000 miles away in Huddersfield.
When we came to Yorkshire, it was really quiet.
I felt like vacation because lots of green there, and I've seen cows more than ever in my life.
It was those pastures new that inspired the couple to set up the business they brought to the deck.
Everybody hungry?
It's a mixing of civilization. The mixing is very, very unique.
I am
Ravid Tantuk. We are looking for £100,000 for 10% of our company.
We are both the founder of Yorkshire Gamma Cheese. So basically, we are originally from Syria. We came here in 2012 because of the war, and we came with nothing. So we started to think about what next. And halloumi cheese is one of our everyday breakfasts in Syria. And we noticed how it is trendy here in the UK nowadays. And we thought about the business idea.
There are here nice cows, lovely milk, and they said, why we are importing from Cyprus. Let's make it in Yorkshire. We both. And I managed to make good halloumi cheese with
cow's milk. We had a very big challenge as halloumi is a trademark in the UK. And we did the rebrand as Creaky Cheese.
We are available in independent farm shops, also many restaurants, and recently we started to supply supermarket portions with our cheese.
Looking samples?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay, cool. A halloumi style cheese made from cow's milk.
Wow, look at that.
Is the offering Razan Alsous and Ragid Santouk hope will make the dragons hungry to invest. They want £100,000 in return for a 10% slice of their business. And it seems Tuka Suleiman already has a connection with the Squeaky Cheese couple. You probably know that I'm of Turkish secret origin. From Cyprus.
Oh.
Halloumi is a big export of Cyprus. But most halloumi in Cyprus is done from goat's milk.
Goat and sheep, yes.
Yeah, goat and sheep, yes, yeah. And I like halloumi. And I do find your story remarkable. You left Syria in 2012?
Because of the war, yes.
And you've come with nothing, and you are where you are today.
Yeah.
That's remarkable, that's good.
It's absolutely delicious. I absolutely love it. But what's your background in Syria? I mean, were you making cheese there?
No. We used to eat it. But I'm an electronic engineer, and I used to go around pharmaceutical companies and supply them the equipment they need. And cheese.
Yeah. I used to do pharmacology, but I just actually love cooking. The milk in the UK is amazing, so why not invest in this local sources and get the business going?
I love this. This is the proper entrepreneurs. You've just spotted an opportunity, and you thought we can do this.
Praise to the entrepreneurs' initiative from Deborah Meaden. But is Tuka Suleiman satisfied the cheese as a tasty business opportunity? So let's just look at some numbers. Do you have the figures for the last 12 months?
Last year we did £183,000.
And your net profit?
25.
Let's just break this down. £183,000. Where does that come from?
Morrison. We supply 1,500 pieces of cheese every week.
They require more, but we don't have the capacity. This is why we are here, because our production is not efficient.
It's very museum equipment, very manual, very manual. We need a proper machine.
So you've come here for me to finance your new machinery?
Yes.
if I give you the 100,000 better today, what will the turnover be next year?
I'm sure it will be 3 times more.
So around 500,000? Yes, lovely.
When you mentioned you want to go from 180,000 to 500,000, where are you planning to do that? Is it in the same distribution outlets or more distribution outlets?
We already got the demand. We did show the product at the wave show, and they did show the interest. They asked us for availability, and we told them when we have the machine, we can start to increase the capacity. Guys, you have a choice now to decide. Do we get somebody else to contract manufacture it for us, or do we carry on making? So the piece of kit you're buying, where are you getting that from?
It will be imported from Europe.
So there's nobody in the UK making halloumi?
No.
There are. Do you two want to talk to each other before you answer?
The cheese or the cheese?
The cheese or the cheese?
The cheese, there are.
There are.
So there are.
If you want to buy the machine that makes halloumi, you have to buy it from.
Yes, like for example, one of the halloumi producers, I'm not sure I'm going to get one in anyways. Right, hold on 1 second. Can I just focus on the question I'm asking?
Yes.
Are there people in the UK making halloumi?
Yes.
There are one. Which is bigger than us. They are
okay, so why don't you talk to them about making a living?
I'm not going to ask them. I will make it myself. Why to ask them?
You seem quite resistant to having it made by somebody else. But if you do a deal with a contract manufacturer, you can actually supply all of the demand that you're talking about. So you can still own the piece.
But we insist to make it. It's something that we are connected to. This is like my new baby here in the UK.
The entrepreneur's refusal to consider outsourcing doesn't sit well with Deborah Meade. And now it seems Peter Jones is finding the Yorkshire-based food producers overly ambitious.
It's really lovely, and I think that you've done a really good job. But you're valuing the company at £1 million, 40 times its profit. There isn't a company on the universe that could sell at that.
You shouldn't take
it from the... No, I'm talking about your value of your company. You've come in and said, I've got a cheese business that's producing £20,000 a year and it's worth £1 million.
But you are coming to our business, which already established, and already got big channels, and we already got the demand.
Yes, but
all
it's not worth the money.
Investing in the machinery to cover all this demand.
But you're not listening because you're just talking.
I can say something. If you are looking at an old house or broken house, but in a luxury area, so you don't evaluate the walls, how good is it, how bad is it painted or not, you evaluate it according to the area where it is, to the future. It will be a fantastic house.
But your business is probably worth in the very low hundreds of thousands, if that. And if I was to make you an offer, I'd have to take far too much of your business away. So, it's very clear where I'm going to go. I don't think this business, at the level that you've asked for, £100,000, is any kind of investment at all. So, for that reason, I'm out.
Peter Jones has no appetite for such a richly valued investment. Does Paige Lalvani feel the same?
The problem I have, which is actually similar to Peter's, is that you're running a business at £1 million. Today, if you were to go outside to them and try and raise money at this valuation, people wouldn't give it to you. So I'm not going to invest, and I'm out.
Guys, I'm
going to
tell you where I am. I'm in Europe.
Thank you.
But I don't think we'd work very well together. You don't want to do the thing that I think you really do need to do right now, which is look at a contract manufacturer. And there's no point in an investment like that. All right.
Disappointment for the entrepreneurs as two more dragons bow out in quick succession. Will Sara Davies be prepared to partner up with the food producers?
Guys, I don't think you should go down the contract manufacturing route, because what I see standing in front of me
are two entrepreneurial cheesemakers, not entrepreneurial marketeers. I like the taste of the movie. But the fundamental problem I've got with it is that I go to the shop looking for the movie. If I saw this next to it, I would pick up a halloumi cheese.
Not Alex.
Yes. Yes. My worry is there's no massive scaling opportunity in this business because you don't have that brand of halloumi. And for that reason, I'm out.
Sara Davies can't see the potential in the business and ends her interest. Tuka Solomon had an early affinity with the couple. Will it translate into an offer?
You know, Sam, I do appreciate when people leave a country and die straight come to a new country. You're very brave to have come from Syria to create what you've done and to come here. That's an achievement in itself. No? So I can understand your passion to yours, your family business. But do I really want to be involved in a family business? That's a question I'm asking myself. And I can also see your reluctance to even think about outsourcing, because it's your baby. But really, I don't want to invest because I think this is your business. So for that reason, I'm out.
Admiration, but no investment for Roseanne and Bradley, and they head back to Huddersfield and
keep going.
Keep going, fine. They miss the job. They miss the job.
Well, the other day, you really would have been a great investment to take your chance with it.
We'll keep making cheese until we have enough money to invest in machines. Always keep working.
Tuchel, I think you're covered for a little bit too easy pressure.
Next to enter the game are Brad and Lady's buddies turned business partners, Martin Driver and Sean Jones. She's got an idea to their home, return packaging into town.
We think they've got a really fun product. It brings out the food in everyone, whatever age you are.
What's good? One dragon in particular.
Sara, we think, is amazing because she's got that amazing product. Networking background.
You can help them
I think we've got a really good idea and we hope they see the potential of it.
What?
I
forgot
we
could pay them.
Yeah, let's hope there's evidence. Don't think that playing with rubbish is rubbish.
Hi, I'm Martin Grimer.
And
I've just joined Sean Jones and Alpine Fox. Today we're looking for an investment for £40,000 for 15% stake in our business. I'm a dad of four wonderful kids. And that hallway at home is constantly blocked with delivery boxes. And I know that I'm not the only one. Our planet is awash with waste packaging. It's reported that Amazon Prime shipped 5 billion packages in 2017. That's an awful lot of boxes to play with. Our kids are spending more and more time on digital devices. And as parents, we worry they're not spending enough time in hands-on imaginative play. Now, we know our kids love to play with boxes, turning them into dragons, dens, cards, or even superhero armbands. So we had an idea, create Punkbox, a brand that enabled kids really simply to be able to transform all that waste packaging we have and turn it into super cool stuff to play with. Our products are themed activity packs that contain cool stickers, things to colour in, cut out, and the fun comics to enable those kids to turn boxes into fun things to play with. We have run a trial with HelloFresh, and we're now talking to them about future opportunities around revenue and partnership. So we hope today you'll be able to join us on our mission to engage kids in the power of reuse and hopefully bring a bit of joy to them in their boxes. We'd love you to try some of our products, and then obviously we'd love to take your questions. Activity packs and stickers to turn waste packaging into fun things to play with for kids of all ages.
I want to get in that car. You're very welcome.
It's the brainchild of London-based entrepreneurs Martin Grimer and Sean Jones.
You can have a loo roll, a water bottle, or a coffee cup.
I'll take a coffee cup. They're looking to box off an investment of £40,000 in return for a 15% stake in their business.
Stickers for that.
Peter Jones, first to get stuck in.
Jordan Martin, hello.
Hello.
I must say, as a dad of five, I've been through this and I get the issue. Actually, I'll tell you a little secret. With some boxes that we've got, I've made things out of the boxes ourselves. And it's been fun colouring them in, felt tips, making cars, making a helmet, doing those sort of things. So I totally get it. What I want to try and hone in on really quickly, though, is how this could become a business as opposed to I'm just going to buy some stickers down at the local supermarket or colour the boxes in myself. What is it that ultimately is going to create a business that hopefully will make money?
I think we make it easier. Lots of people play with boxes, but actually the fact that you can buy these stickers, it kind of makes it easy. It's really complex. That's play.
Yeah.
The idea is rather than looking at someone partners, who have got appropriate types of boxes that we can partner with, making super simple, you can get the products in the box, so it's kind of fresh and really great because the consumer would get their products and then they could take our products out and the kids could take them to something fun.
And I love it. Yes, I've got my art and craft hat on with the business side over here, but it's actually even more. This is the sort of thing I do with my kids all the time.
That's great.
And do you know how hard it is, what clearly you do, to buy wheels that are the right size to make a box look like a car?
We're doing a lot of wheels.
So I think you've definitely got something here. I really do. And what I'm most interested in is what you've talked about with HelloFresh. So, just
talk me through what the feedback's been. So we shared the idea with them and they kind of loved it straight away, said we'd love to get this into our boxes. It's all about basically turn the first box into a fridge and 5,000 products went out.
So they paid you for the product?
Yeah, we invested in a trial with them.
Right.
We thought we had to, you know, this opportunity.
Yeah.
So it was a great opportunity for us to look and validate our concept.
Sarah Davies discovers that the packaging propositions tie up with a household name isn't quite as peachy as she'd first imagined. Paige Alvani now wants to dig a bit deeper into the way the pair are hoping to turn trash into treasure.
How much it cost you for a pack of stickers, and how much are you going to be selling it for?
Sure. So we're looking at about £4.99, and that'd be around £1.10 to produce.
We're talking about HelloFresh. What other companies would you like to get a partnership?
Some really good examples for us would be Footwear, for instance. We feel that working with shoe manufacturers would be a really good idea.
It'd be good idea because they've got scale.
You have just spent a lot of money on marketing, trying to get people convinced to buy these stickers, and yet staring me in the face, or stares me in the face, every brand, and I've got two brands, want brand loyalty. They want their customers to be loyal to them. If you went to a shoe brand, you went to a brand, you custom make designs for each brand, they buy stickers off you, and you say, right, this will cost you £2 per sticker, with a message in your luggage. We'll provide that to you, provide to your customers for free, to create brand loyalty. So you're really opening doors with big brands, and then the more you print these things, the cheaper they get. I reckon you've probably been down to 20p, you had enough?
We have thought of that idea. We were unsure that actually a business would buy our proposition in terms of giving it away to free the Americans.
Well, I'm going to tell you, most brands, they pay for the 20% commission to get a customer. If I were an investor, I could make a phone call, put in front of another people and say, could you sell that to them to create more customer interest in making their product?
Yeah. To consumers, there's a clear path to market, a
throwing his sizable contacts book into the mix for good measure. Deborah Meaden's eco-credentials mean she's receptive to planet-saving products. But has she spotted something in their kit of parts that might cause the duo to come unstuck?
Are these eco-friendly? Is the glue environmentally friendly? Is the ink environmentally friendly?
So, the inks and the materials are... The adhesive is a bit of a grey area. I think anybody who is involved in working with stickers, there are challenges around sustainability.
But there are labels you can get that are eco-friendly, use an eco-friendly adhesive. And if you're going to hang your hat on sustainability, you've got to properly tell that story, because there'll be two reasons why you work with partners. One will be, it's a cool idea. There's absolutely no doubt about that. It's a great idea. But if you are going to hang your hat on sustainability, you have to prove it's going to make a difference.
I think what we're trying to do is we're trying to instill a behaviour of reuse in children.
Yeah, in terms of the reuse, are you not adding to the packaging issue? After a day of doing that, I've still got the box in the hall, I'm then throwing that out.
I completely agree with you. All the time, lay the box going into the recycling, it doesn't stop the box going into the recycling. So, that kind of doesn't tick the sustainability box for me. And also, you are manufacturing something. The minute you produce something, it is less sustainable than just allowing them to put that cardboard box straight into the bin.
Yes, we are creating and already manufacturing, but we feel that actually the behavioural change that we can focus on with those kids, we get really thinking at an early age about being better for the environment, is our key focus.
Yeah, you see, the trouble is my worry is it teaches them to think that it's actually okay to reuse something. This is what greenwash is all about, isn't it? People just feeling better, but it having no impact on the planet whatsoever. And what you're doing here isn't stopping anything being produced, in fact, it's creating more production. So I am really sorry, I won't be investing. I might.
Deborah Meaden falls apart the environmental claims to prepare presentation and spin their brand. And if you hear a page of our own, that is a good place on the page to the content.
I don't think it's such a big issue about sustainability thing, because I've been able to see what I'm sort of struggling with where the business model is. Getting feedback, but we're just not getting into the business. That's why we're all concerned. So, unfortunately, for those reasons, I'm going to say, it's good enough to have other work. Get that. I actually love it. I think it's great. But the reality is, the critical flaw in the whole concept of bringing out a business like this is that I've had a lot of fun colouring in those things myself, and I haven't had to buy something else. So I admire you as individuals who are thinking outside of that box about how to make that box better. But sadly, as a business going forward, I don't believe that that's a sustainable model. So for that reason, I'm out.
Peter Jones feels the sticker startup is fundamentally flawed and walks away from the deal. Before they entered the deck, Martin and Sean singled out crafting queen Sarah Davies as the dragon in the most to win over. And it would appear she might be sold on their upcycling offering.
I would love to invest in it. I love it. I love it with my cropped hat on. I love it with my mummy hat on. I would really want to, but the business is not worth anywhere near what you valued it at. So to give you 40 grand today, I'd have to significantly change the valuation and ask for a fair chunk of the business. And right now, I don't think you've worked out what the model is. You'll then just fritter away the 40 grand, and Bank of Sarah here, it's got to throw more good money into the bag and then I've got to come ask for more of your company, because I've got to look at this as a commercial venture, not just something I'm doing because it feels nice. So I'm really sorry, guys. As devastated as I am, it's not a one for me, and I'm out.
Tara Davies' business brain has too many reservations about the money-making potential of the product, and she exits the negotiations. Only to Kasuma remains. He's already offered to get out his contract, but is he ready to dial up a deal? I love creativity. I'm torn because I can see it. And I'd love to give you guys a chance. And for me, if you went to Marks and Spencer's, you got them to agree, yeah, great. So I would like to invest in you.
Well, I've done my toilet roll.
Oh, I've done my desktop. I didn't know I had a desktop practice here.
Yeah. The next entrepreneur, hoping to be greeted with investment, thought he'd let his clock do the talking.
Personalizing it, and now adding audio and video to it. With this in mind, we created Talkie, the next generation of greeting card.
It looked like London-based David Hyam had played his card right, with his message for two custodians. But some of David's personalized greeting didn't go down quite so well.
Name on,
Mr. Jones thought the card lacked some sophistication.
That's a printed wrapper. How do you stuck it on?
Yeah.
I don't understand. Charles could do that.
What? Create a website to sell?
No. Yeah, well, yes.
Yeah. Anybody can do a greeting card site. This is doing a greeting card with video.
But I've got that.
Super Crafter, Sarah Davies, bought and sold on the card's aesthetic value.
The fundamental
problem
I've got is, I want that to look awesome. What I see on that table there, doesn't even come close to rivaling what the competitors in that space are doing.
These are just prototypes. The creativity that's going to come out of this is going to be awesome. We will create something that is completely new, and it will be a lot of work for anybody else to do it.
I find it really hard to believe that one of the big players would have the value to enter that you're saying they would.
And when it came to his numbers, the entrepreneur failed to get the message across.
The financials, we hope to get to $400,000 for the first year.
And cost of goods?
They may have tried to rescue him on the numbers, but the other dragons couldn't save David from being dealt those fateful cards.
I'm out. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Although not all the dragons found it as easy to close the door on the pit. Can I switch it off?
Where is it?
Next up, her best friend, Nancy Zeppelin, and Eileen Williams. She found that partnering up in business has brought them closer than ever.
A bit like a marriage. This is my other half.
Yeah, this is my other half.
Between the two of us, we've had 6 children and 3 dogs. Just 2 husbands.
When it comes to pairing up with a dragon, the entrepreneurs have one in particular they want to work.
Peter's, has just started a new lifestyle and
it's going on well.
Yeah.
And the messages they've had from friends and family are helping them to get in the zone.
Lots of affirmation texts this morning. You can do it! Smash it! Fantastic!
Okay, come on.
Hello Dragons, I'm Nancy.
And hi, I'm Eileen. We're Cucumber Clothing and we're here today to ask for £50,000 in exchange for 10% of the business. Cucumber Clothing is here to solve a problem. We make clothing and sleepwear for women who get hot. That is our USP. Women get hot for so many different reasons. It can be as simple as a monthly cycle. It can be women who are pregnant and breastfeeding, women who are going through the menopause, and also curvier women. We think that this is the future of fashion. We take beautiful designs and we marry them to famous fabrics, which not only feel gorgeous to wear, but they keep you looking and feeling cool night and day.
All our fabrics we use last up to 6 times longer than cotton. They do not retain special odours, and they're anti-crease, which is really good for the environment. Cucumber Clothing is an innovative marketplace. Together with the Dragon, we're really excited about our future. We have a few pieces we'd like to hand out, and then we're ready for some questions.
Clothing to keep women cool is a concept and business partner Nancy Zeppelin and Eileen Willis. They want £50,000 in exchange for 10% of the business.
What do you want?
We have. You've got the dress version. I'm wearing the jumpsuit.
But will Sara Daly buy into the sartorial setup?
Thank you, Eileen. Well, thank you. So what's the background for you this morning? So we've known each other for almost 20 years and we realised that so many of the conversations amongst the friendship groups around issues are getting hot. We really feel that the market has not been using the school and doing a great market. We do have very dominated ambition. At some point we'd love to think this is our market, we dominated it, we were the first.
Okay, just give me an idea. So this piece that I've got is 90. What is the cost for this finished piece for you and what do you sell?
On average, all our pieces, they cost us £25 and on average they sell at £83. The dress that I'm wearing is out in a couple of weeks, so it's going to be £135. I'm wearing the most expensive thing, which is
£125. Okay. I do a lot of work with the TV shopping panels.
Okay.
And as you can imagine, the TV shopping attracts a lot of women who I think will be your core demographic.
Right.
I can picture you two on air, wearing the product, and women really buying into that. It will absolutely work in that environment.
Okay.
However, what will not work in that environment is the price.